Good morning and welcome to worship at Old South Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, on this rather gloomy, damp, rainy Sunday morning. Welcome. I'm glad if you're here in person in the sanctuary, or if you're joining us on YouTube, or you're joining us on Zoom, or if you're watching this worship service in the days or weeks that follow on our YouTube channel. Welcome. I'm glad that you're here. Glad that we can gather together as God's people during this holy season of Lent. Welcome. I'm so glad that you're here. And I would encourage you as we begin this worship service to open your hearts and minds to be present in this place, to listen in for how the Holy Spirit is at work in our midst and in us and around us and joining us as we gather here. So welcome. I hope that you feel ready to be a people at worship, to be nurtured, strengthened, nourished by the God who loves you more than you can imagine. So welcome. We begin as we, oh, let me say one more thing. If you're joining us remotely, if you are not on the church's regular email list, you can find our bulletin today for today's service on our webpage in the upper right-hand corner. You'll find the bulletin and the words to the hymns there. Other than that, I think we're ready to begin. So we'll start with a prelude and I'll turn it over to Brad.
Oh, Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship, invocation, and Lord's Prayer. Our Lenten journey continues. As we worship and praise,
opening our hearts and minds,
show us the way of faithfulness,
and bless us with your grace,
that we may be assured of your presence today and always. Let us pray. Loving and merciful God, as we make our way through this holy season, we place our trust in you, that we may grow in faith and in love. We endeavor to live in your way and follow your commandment to love you with heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves, even those who are difficult to love. Bless with strength and courage that we may live as you have called us to live. In the name of our Savior, we pray. The one who taught us to pray together, our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Wendy. And now we'll sing together our first hymn. You'll find it in the New Century Hymnal, the Black Hymnal, number 400. The words are also on the back of the announcements page, Christ is Made the Sure Foundation.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm reading Psalm 51, which is on page 520 in the Pew Bible, if you'd like to follow along. It's a prayer for cleansing and pardon. To the leader, a psalm of David, when the prophet Nathan came to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain me in a willing spirit.
Thank you, Don, very much. For those of you who are here last week, you will have heard the first part of Paul's letter to the church in Corinth in chapter 12. And so we're sort of following along, and we're focused today on neighbors who are offer a bit more challenge in terms of loving them. Last week, we did the easy ones. So now we're moving on to the more challenging. So again, I'll be reading and we'll be focusing on 1 Corinthians 12. And I think I'm going a little bit beyond verse 27, but starting at verse 12. We'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. So if you're following along with one of the Bibles in the pews, it should, there shouldn't be any surprises. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one spirit we are all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we are all made to drink of one spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor. Our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts. And I will show you a still more excellent way. Here ends our reading from Scripture. May God bless us with understanding. Amen. We've been focusing this Lent on the various aspects of how we show love and devotion to God with a guide. And with sort of taking some of the wise words from Micah's prophecy in the Old Testament on what is required of the faithful, as well as the greatest commandment to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and its companion, to love our neighbor as ourselves. Today, we consider what it means to love those neighbors who are difficult to love. And we'll use Paul's teaching for some help and wisdom on this topic. Last week, someone, when I was saying something about, you know, moving on to the more difficult people, mentioned enemies and needing to love our enemies. Most of us are likely very familiar with the teaching that Jesus offered near the end of the Sermon on the Mount regarding enemies. You have heard that it was said you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who harass you. Well, we're not going to deal with the enemies today. They're a whole other subject. They're a whole other category. Today, we're not really going to talk about them and the challenges associated with loving our neighbors, though there are many. Instead, we're going to bring the subject a bit closer to home and consider those who are not really people we consider to be enemies, but still, they are difficult in the loving department. If I asked you to take a moment to think of people in this category, people that you know deep down inside, where really push comes to shove, you would say, yes, I love that person, but you do find it challenging. You would say, oh, I don't often like that person. How long does it take for you to come up with a couple of names? You start scrolling through your brain. I mean, there's so many all at once, you don't even know where to start. Right? It takes a second, maybe half a second. I'm glad I'm not alone. We all have people who pose some challenges for us when it comes to the commandment to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbor as ourselves. Among the candidates of those who are difficult to love, it could be a family member or someone who's part of your group of friends. You don't need to raise your hand. You don't need to do anything. Just throwing out some possibilities if you are finding it challenging to think of a few names. It could be someone, a family member, could be someone in your group of friends. It could be somebody in this room. It could be the person you're looking at. For some, let's be honest, it is hard to know where to begin. There are a lot of candidates. The list for some is long, or at least for me, it can be very long. This is a really challenging aspect of faith. We were joking around last night. Joseph was like, what are you going to say about that? Yeah, it's challenging, right? There are people in our lives who cause us frustration, cause us deep worry and concern, right? If only they would just get it together and cause me a little bit less, we could all get along a little bit better. It can be very challenging. And these are people we need to spend some time thinking a little bit about. Many years ago, when I was serving a different church, I came to realize that though the congregation was not especially large, there were two very distinct multi-generational families, right? You can see kind of where this is going, who did not interact with each other. They sat on opposite sides of sanctuary, and they only spoke to each other when it was absolutely necessary. And absolutely necessary did not happen. I don't know if it even happened all the time I was there. They did not speak to each other and did not interact. At some point, I was told that the patriarch of one of these families wanted to meet with me, and he wanted me to come and visit him in his home. So I did. And the visit was all about making sure I knew his side of the story. The gentleman was quite elderly, and it was difficult to understand all the different bits of this story. There was a lot that he kind of threw at me, and some of it was kind of garbled. So I really was trying to pay attention and listen in, and I started piecing together. It was like a little bit of a puzzle, these different little bits, and piecing them all together. And they discovered that the difficulty between these two families had something to do with a member, of course, of the other family saying something mean about, I think, an outfit or some shoes that were worn by someone in this man's family. And I think it was, you know, a child. And this man and the rest of his family took offense. And were so outraged that they decided not to speak to the other family. And as I sat there listening to the story and trying to make sense of what he was telling me, it became clearer and clearer that this strange little feud that he was describing was rooted in a slur that had taken place decades before. When I started realizing that this poor child who was, you know, something mean was said about her, you know, is now like a woman in her 60s or 70s, I gotta say, I was a little taken aback. Decades, these two families had not interacted or really spoke. They would not speak to each other. And I will say this, there were two aspects of what was so astonishing was that A, that they had held this grudge over something that seemed so small for so long. And two, that they were both still there in this small church, sitting on opposite sides of the sanctuary, going about both families very active, doing stuff they just never did anything where they really had to directly interact with each other. It was a weird thing. And it was, if I had known, and I really wish at the time, like, would they characterize their relationship in any way as loving? Like, they didn't like each other, but they shared this space. And I don't, it's an interesting question. But ultimately, I think for many of us, there are people in our lives who are difficult to love, whether that difficulty is founded on something deeply important or something that's really pretty superficial, or at least seems that way. There are also kind of two components that I'd like to at least touch on very briefly today. And those are, there are people who are difficult to love who share this worshiping community. I mean, let's be honest, mostly, I mean, I don't think there are the two families that won't speak to each other. But still, right, there are some issues that get expressed, certainly to me. And there are moments when there are people who are difficult to love. And then, of course, there are people in our wider sort of group. When we go outside of this church, people in our families, people among people that we consider our friends, who can be difficult to love. Now, it seems fairly clear that even Paul and the early Christians that he ministered to experienced this same sort of situation, that there are those that are close by, those who share our worshiping community, who can be difficult to love. And Paul comes up with some advice that is pretty useful. And that is to think about something that is really very close, an object lesson that is incredibly easy to access, involving the bodies we inhabit. Take a look, right? If you can't really see your own, maybe look next door around you, right? We inhabit these amazing bodies with these different pieces and parts, aspects of our bodies that do different and weird things. Sometimes they work together pretty well. Sometimes they don't, especially as we get older. But there are different pieces. There are obvious things, and then there are the things, there are the weird organs in there. Who knows really where they are, but we know they're important. They contribute to how we are, how we exist, how we interact, how we live and breathe. They're important. Here's this great object lesson that we're walking around with, right? We have really no excuse not to really allow this lesson to sink in. It's right there. It's right here. That we live with these bodies that teach us how the body of Christ works. Right? We're not going to always understand. Right? The hand maybe doesn't always understand what the foot is up to. Again, especially as we get older, there can be issues. Why is my knee not cooperating? Why is my hip hurt? But they teach us something about how the body of Christ is set up. We're not all, not any single one of us is the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ together. We cannot be singular bodies of Christ. It does not work that way. We are together, the body of Christ. So yes, occasionally there are going to be places where there's going to, well, you know, I don't really like how that piece of the body of Christ is expressing itself. And yet we must remind ourselves how important it is that we recognize the significance. And it's not up to us to judge the significance of the pieces and the parts of the body of Christ. That's not our job. Job is to do our best to incorporate, to allow to flourish, to allow to grow the various aspects, even when they provide some difficulty. Somebody pushes us out of our comfort zone. Somebody does something that we just don't really like. Take a moment. You know, you're not going to not do that anymore. But I think the practice is then to take a moment, take a breath, and remind yourself that we are the body of Christ. Do the best that we can to allow the body of Christ to express itself. And understand there's always going to be something. And again, and then if there isn't, then it really means that we're sort of dampened down the movement of the Spirit. Because the Spirit has a habit of surprising us once in a while. And that's a good thing. And then if we can do that, and if we can help ourselves practice understanding that we together are the body of Christ, and that we have different places where not any single one of us, right? You wouldn't want me preaching and singing. That would not be a good worship experience, let me tell you. Right? We depend on each other. And if we can do that, really try to see it as a practice, it'll be a whole lot easier when we deal with the larger community, when we deal with our families, when we deal with our friends, to take a moment to find that moment of grace that we are blessed with. All we need to do is access it. It is there. Moment of grace to appreciate that for whatever reason, God has created this amazingly diverse creation, and within humanity, amazingly diverse, with various gifts and talents, some that we recognize, we appreciate, and some we still have a few questions about. Yet, our job is to help this body flourish, to practice here in this safe space, then to go out and be about that ministry. It's hard. It's hard for me. So let us help each other. Let us continue to encourage each other in this hard work. Being the body of Christ, not just when we're in these walls, when we're out there as well. Right? You don't need to watch too much news to realize how important this ministry is. So let us be about this holy work, and let us continue, again, to help encourage each other and engage in this holy work to be the body of Christ. May God continue to be with us, helping us, showing us the way, giving us a pat on the back, pushing us occasionally. May God continue to bless us to be the body of Christ that we are called to be. Amen.
I want to thank the Pine Tree Academy Mixed Quartet. It's actually a new group from Pine Tree Academy because this happens to be this week is their break, and so most of the students are away. So fortunately, Emma and Gordy, a brother and sister, they live locally, and they were able to sing. So I'll be singing tenor, and Dr. Westbeck will be adding with the alto. My mother was gracious enough to play the piano for both selections. For the dismissal or the benediction response, we'll actually be singing a full anthem, the Old Irish Blessings, considering it's St. Patrick's Day. So it's not a 40-second piece, so you may be sit if you like rather than waiting as we sing. Thank you.
Watching for you and
you so much. Now we're moving on to our mission moment, and I'm very pleased to introduce, if you've never met her before, Liz Charles McGough. She's the director at PL, has been now for years.
That's right.
And she's going to share a little bit more about PL.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
As Pastor Susan said, my name is Liz, and I'm beginning my third year as the director of Pilgrim Lodge. For those of you who don't know about our program, we are the outdoor ministries program of the main conference, United Church of Christ. So while we dedicate the majority of our summer season to youth programming and week-long summer camp experiences for children, we really have a program that serves all ages, and I'm excited to share that with you today. I also am so pleased to be with you so that I can come and express my gratitude for the many ways that your congregation supports Pilgrim Lodge. I know that among folks in your church, there is a history of volunteerism, relationship, and financial support to our ministry. So I'm grateful to come in person and say thank you for that support. I'm also excited to share with you a little bit about what we're up to, some of the newer things happening at camp, so that I can really lift up how your support and engagement makes our camp ministry possible as we seek to live our values. So a little bit about our values. First of all, love of children. We seek to provide purposeful programming that centers around supporting our children in their growth and wellness. We've implemented talking circles as a means of building community, tending community, and supporting conflict resolution as we seek to practice new ways of sharing, listening, and building empathy. Speaking of those hard to love neighbors, we're really trying to build up our toolkits for how to get along with one another and live in the world beyond camp. We also know that mental health considerations are significant for our children at this moment in time. And so we seek to be ready to support a space of wellness, but also provide our staff and volunteers with training on how to recognize mental health considerations and work as a team to support our campers. Love of neighbor is another value of our Pilgrim Lodge camp program. This past summer, we began to introduce a learning journey as at camp, we seek to learn more about the history of our place. We are located in West Garner on Lake Cabasakanti, and we are really trying to understand the history of the indigenous people who were there first and how we can, as a community, be in right relationship with our current Wabanaki neighbors. At the beginning of each camp session, we offer a land acknowledgement, which lifts up those neighbors and the work we are doing to continue engagement, learning, and action. Love of creation is another value at camp. For this summer, for the first time ever, we are partnering with the BTS Center to provide our first ever climate justice camp for high school age campers. During this unique and powerful week, young people will have the opportunity to explore imagination, kinship, and grief within the context of a climate change world. Climate Justice Camp begins with honesty about the hard realities of the climate crisis and offers a grounded hope that is deeper than wishful thinking. Campers will learn about climate science as it relates to Maine's ecosystems and watersheds right at Pilgrim Lodge in the forest and the lake where Pilgrim Lodge is located. We will be invited to hold an imaginative posture that encourages us to move our vision from what is to what if. And our fourth value, open and affirming. We seek to welcome and affirm campers from all walks of life and continue our commitment to Camp Pride, a week-long program for LGBTQ youth and allies. In an effort to maintain a space for relationships beyond the teenage years, our camp leadership created Pride Across the Ages, which had its inaugural summer last year. Pride Across the Ages is a multi-generational program for adults, individuals, and families of all ages and generations to come together in a community centered around LGBTQ identity, recognizing the importance of relationships that affirm all version of family and the power of learning from and listening across generations. We will offer both programs again this coming summer. So this is an invitation to all of you to be part of this ministry. Camp is not just for youth, as Pastor Susan shared, but there is a multitude of programs for adults as well. There are spring and fall women's retreats. There are a variety of multi-generational family programs called Sabbath Stories and S'mores, Expedition Everyone, Pride Across the Ages, and Family Camp. We also welcome programs where grandparents bring their grandchildren to introduce them to camp. And Lighten Up, Loosen Up is a program for adults of all genders, encouraging folks to take time to be in retreat, rest, relax, and enjoy a faith-centered community together. The favorite data point that I like to share from last summer is that our youngest camper was 3 months old and our oldest was 89. So please come join the circle and be part of our ministry. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Liz. And to help us put a little bit more to our really long-term commitment to Pilgrim Lodge and to hear more about what's going on and to hear about the sort of old sort of standby programs that have been going on for a long time, but as well to hear about new things that are happening at Pilgrim Lodge and perhaps to inspire a couple of people to consider spending some real quality time at Pilgrim Lodge. After all, for us, it's not far. It's although I will say I have found sometimes it's a little complicated to get there. Like, it's just right there. But the roads are a little weird. Anyway, it's not hard. It's very close. So thank you again. We come now to our time of offering. Consider how we give of ourselves, how we are called to give of ourselves in this time, to consider all of our various offerings, how we give of our gifts and talents, how we encourage each other in the giving of and sharing of gifts and talents. For again, we are the body of Christ together. We need each other, and we need to support and encourage each other on this journey. And we also take a moment to consider our financial support to this small community, this ministry that is so important to this part of the world. So we take a moment if you've to consider how we support this. And as well, if you wish to support our outreach offering for this month that is going most Sundays, except for last Sunday, most Sundays of March, we'll go to Pilgrim Lodge and you'll find outreach envelopes in the and around the pews, and you can put your offering for outreach, the outreach fund in there. But we do take a moment to consider that if you brought a financial offering to share today, if you're here in the sanctuary, you may bring it forward during the offertory and place it in the offering plate that's in the front pew over here or behind the candles on this side. And if you are joining us remotely, there are instructions for how to give on our website and in the news and notes during the week. So let us prayerfully consider our offerings, our various offerings, and be in the spirit of prayer as we ask for assistance in sharing of the gifts and talents that we have been blessed with. seated. We come now to our time of prayer, and I will at first invite you to spend a moment in some silence to lift up what is on your own heart today, and as well to open your heart and listen in for how God is speaking to you today before I lead us together. Let us pray. We thank you and praise you, gracious and holy God, for gathering us together this day. We thank you and praise you for gathering us as your people, as the body of Christ. We ask for your blessing, O God, that we will continue to take seriously and be conscientious about what it means for us to gather as the body of Christ, that you will help us and guide us when we struggle with some parts of the body, when there are gifts that we do not recognize, when there are talents that are not allowed to express themselves. Bless us, O God, with your grace and your courage, that we will always endeavor to live more fully as the body of Christ, recognizing the significance and importance of each one, our dependence on each one, that not one of us can be the body of Christ, that we need to work and be together. On this day, we lift up our gratitude and praise for outdoor ministries, for the opportunities to be and the wonderful, spectacular bit of nature that we live in. For those who are able to go to camp, to take time away, to be nourished and strengthened through the beauty of the natural world. We lift up our gratitude and our praise for those with the gift of music and song, willing to share it with us today. We ask, O God, for your help and for your strength as we seek to reach out to all of our various neighbors and to learn to show love, whether it is easy to come by or much more challenging. And as we gather this day, we lift up into your presence, O God, our broken hearts for the war and the chaos that is happening all over the world, and even in places not far from where we worship today. We are heartbroken at the senseless loss of life, a lack of respect for your gift of life. We are heartbroken and overwhelmed So help us, O God. Strengthen us to be the people you need to be, to bring peace, hope, and healing wherever we can, and to always hold in prayer those whose lives are in constant danger, and those first responders who rush in to be of help and assistance. Bless us all this day, O God, and help us again to be the people you need us to be, that you call us to be, in this place, in this part of the world, that we may continue to be about your holy and good work today and always. In the name of our Savior, our friend, our guide, our teacher, we pray, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Now we'll sing together our final hymn, Forward Through the Ages. You'll find it in the Pilgrim hymnal, number 383. The words are also on the back of the announcements page. We come to the end of our worship this day, the beginning of our ministry into the world this week. Before I offer you some words of blessing, just a reminder that after the blessing, you are invited to be seated because the response is a little bit longer than it usually is. So please be aware of that. You don't have to stand through all of that. But hear these words of blessing as we come to the end of the worship this day. Take these words of blessing with you, that it may nourish you as you go about this hard work of ministry. The way is long, let us go together. The way is difficult, let us help each other. The way is joyful, let us share it. The way is open before us, so let us go with the love of God, with the grace of Jesus Christ, and with the communion of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. And may God's peace be with you always. Amen. Thank you.